course, we are back. Guess who's back? Back again. Simon's back. Let's go.
Yes, we are back, and I feel a bit like Bilbo from Lord of the Rings. We went on an adventure and we came back again with a story to tell. When I say we, I speak about Chris, my brother, and myself, yours truly. Chris, viel lieber an dich, mein Freund. And without him, I wouldn't have done it. I wouldn't have attempted this thing. And we both absolutely crushed it. We went there, we took the challenge, and we both came home as winners, to be honest. So I want to give you a little recap of the whole race experience from my personal point of view, how I felt it. I think Chris will do a video about it as well. So as you know, we did the 100 mile race in Berlin. It was a race going all along the former way of the Berlin Wall, because Berlin was of course separated after the Second World War in Eastern and Western Berlin. And this stretched across a distance of in total 100 miles or 160 kilometers. So first of all, about the course itself, the run itself, or the way itself, was absolutely amazing, really, really historical. You have a lot of different parts where, I will try to put some pictures here because I took a few pictures. You have a lot of different parts where actually victims who tried to go from the west, from the eastern part to the western part, over the wall, got killed. And this race, every single year, dedicates a little memory or, you know, a thought to one victim, which they pick out. And the victim, by the way, is even put on the medal, which we received. And in that sense, it was super, super interesting, also from a historical point of view. And it gave you a new perspective about the dimensions which we are speaking about. When it comes to the Berlin Wall at the time, which is absolutely insane. So to be honest with you, I started out the race and I felt absolutely great. You know, I didn't have any complaints. I had fresh legs. I was mentally crystal clear, and I was completely focused on what was ahead. So we were speaking about 160 kilometers. So I knew damn well that it would be a long, long day and probably also a long night. And it was a long night, let me tell you that. I will speak about that in a second. And you know, from the get-go, I didn't have the thought in my mind that I would fail this race, fail, quote unquote, that I would not be able to finish this race. I really tried to completely eliminate this thought, even though it was, of course, a bit delusional, because it was absolutely an opportunity, if we are honest, but you need to be a bit delusional if you do this kind of stuff, you know. Which person which is not delusional would do an ultramarathon of 100 miles, so in any case. With that being said, I took off and I had like, I think a 5:30, 5:40 pace, probably during the first 50 kilometers, to be honest. So I had a really, really solid pace. But to be honest with you, I knew that the pace wouldn't really be a factor. I tried to run according to my heart frequency. So I picked 145 beats per minute. And I always paid attention to my watch that I stayed in this range. And this worked out really well. And I felt like I was flying through the first 50 kilometers. You know, me and Chris, we were always communicating a bit. We were sending each other audio messages. And he said to me that he felt completely fresh as well. When he did his first marathon, he was still doing good, 42 kilometers. And there, I already said to him, okay, my legs, they start to, you know, feel it a bit. But it was fine, completely fine. So from the 50 to the 100 kilometer mark, things were still going really, really, really good, I have to say. So I was still running in a really, really good pace. And above all, I was running all the time pretty much. Here, I didn't have any necessity, any need to walk or to walk a certain stretch of the distance. And I was feeling really good, you know. I was going from aid station to aid station. And oftentimes I was also thinking from aid station to aid station, that especially this way to think, it helped me later in the run, which I really noticed. But during the 50 and the 100 kilometer mark, of course, here I noticed that, yeah, the first muscle fatigue hit a bit, and I felt a bit that my energy levels just went down, you know. I was still completely able, of course, to continue to run, and I also didn't think about finishing or stopping the race, because I was still feeling really good and didn't have any major issues going on, you know. So then I arrived at the 100 kilometer checkpoint, and to be honest, from here things started to get a bit more complicated, but still I was doing quite fine, you know. From 100 kilometers, I said to myself, damn, okay, you have 100 kilometers. And I remember that before the race, or a few days before the race, I said to my father, and also to my friend with which I spoke, that when I arrive at 100 kilometers, and I know I still have 60 kilometers to go, if I find a good reason why I should continue, then I will continue this thing. Because to be honest, you already did 100 kilometers. Why would you run another 60? Let's be honest here. 100 kilometers is a good stretch, right? And if you're feeling great, if you don't have any physical or mental problems, which I didn't have, I could just continue. So, you know, I was going inside myself and I said to myself, let's push, let's go for this. And that is exactly what I was doing. I started feeling it in my legs, I have to say, and slowly, I would say around the 110 kilometer mark, my shin splints started to make themselves recognizable. So my shins, they kind of started to lock up really, and my ankles started to have light swelling. And here I said to myself, shit, okay, you know, I need to find a solution for that. I need to kind of course, to some degree, ignore this pain and just to continue. But I also need to figure out maybe how I can run with a better technique, if I need to alternate between walking and running. And that is also what I started doing, I would say, around the 115 until 130 mark already. I was mostly running, but sometimes walking. And things really started to go down the shitter from the 130 kilometer mark. So when I arrived at the 130 kilometers, I finished it in 14 hours. So it took me 14 hours to run 130 kilometers. For me personally, it was a really, really good time. You know, I couldn't complain about that at all. I think I had an average of 6 minutes and 36 seconds per kilometer. I was super happy about that. And I really realized, Simon, you are really 30 kilometers out of the race, you know. Of course, you saw, especially at 130 kilometers, at some aid station, I saw people literally dropping out. So, you know, there was also ambulance everywhere at the aid stations. And I looked at a few people and I saw the agony, the pain, and the second guessing in their faces. And I would be lying if I didn't have that, you know, if I would say I didn't have that. I was thinking about it at this point, because I was in absolute misery, you know. Here I had so much pain, my shin splints, they got so horrible, and I have to say that every step pretty much hurt. And here's kind of where things started to become crazy, because from 30 kilometers until 160 kilometers, I was pretty much walking a huge, huge part of the race, or of the 30 kilometers. I was still able to run a bit. So also here I was alternating between running and walking, but I was walking the biggest part. And this really helped me, because it was kind of demoralizing at some points, because try to walk 30 kilometers, you will realize how long this is. And this is super interesting, because Chris said this to me after the race, and he's 100% spot on. This was really a question of patience, you know, of patience and of will, because here I didn't have much left, physically speaking. So I really needed to kind of not motivate, but to find a reason for myself to actually say to myself, okay, is it worth it to walk the rest? And it was absolutely worth it, because I absolutely wanted to finish this thing. And in fact, the last 30 kilometers, they took me 11 hours, while the first 130 kilometers, like I said to you, took me 14 hours. So can you imagine how slow I was during the last 30 kilometers? It was a night of misery. I was mostly walking alone. You know, there were not a lot of runners left anymore. In fact, there were a few hundred meters in front of me. I saw some lights, then somebody was coming from behind, usually some 60-year-old, which jogged past me slightly, giving me still some motivating words. One guy, he saw me walking and he was running past me, and he just said, oh damn, good luck. I said to him, thank you, have a good race. So, you know, you have these kind of situations too, but you need to, you know, stay for yourself in a sense. You need to think about what you can do to push forward. And then I luckily ran into a group of two guys. I don't think you will ever see this video, but if you do, much, much love to you. You really pushed me. And with these guys, I started to do runs or running of 1 kilometer, then walking 1 kilometer. Running 1 kilometer, walking 1 kilometer. And then we did around 15 or 20 kilometers like that. And eventually, I needed to leave them for the last 10 kilometers because I literally couldn't run anymore. I barely couldn't walk because the lower part of my leg was just locked up. I'd have no pain in my thighs. I didn't have any pain in my thighs during the race, also not in my hamstrings, nothing. Like I said, just the chin splints and my ankles, they were completely battered. So I was walking the last 10 kilometers, and here I'd say I almost fell asleep also a few times. And you know, you need to think, like, there was a house, and you know, when you have windows, and in front of the window there's this little space where you can put flowers and this kind of stuff. So sometimes I was just me, I was putting my head like that, and I just hoped that nobody was inside to see me. So I did that for, like, honestly only 30 seconds or 1 minute, and then I continued. I didn't sleep at all, so I really ran it. I stayed in movement all the time, let's say, apart from the aid stations, of course. I didn't sleep. One time I tried to sleep, I was running, I was lying down on a park bench because I was so exhausted. But then I realized that I was just getting too cold, you know, I was starting to shiver, and because it was like 3 a.m. I think, or 2 a.m. in the morning. So I need to continue moving. So I was only there for like 5 minutes, and yeah, and then I started walking again. So like that, I arrived in the finish line at 160 kilometers. And after the finish line, I actually went into my car because I couldn't go into my hotel yet because I booked another hotel room and I could only check in from 3 p.m. So I needed to sleep in my car for a few hours, and it was the best sleep of my life. And then, I actually met up with Chris afterwards, still completely in my sports clothes. That was also funny, you know. And what can I say else, you know, as a final thought? To be honest with you, it was probably the best experience of my life with regards to sports. You know, I've never done anything like it, of course, and I absolutely want to do this kind of stuff again. It was such a journey to myself, because I really, really realized what kind of potential I have, you know. I really realized that when you really notice you have nothing left, or you really think you have nothing left, you have much more left, you know. If, of course, again, if you don't have major shutdowns of the system, which I didn't have, fortunately, God bless. And so honestly, these 100 miles, they really took a part of my soul, but they also gave me a bigger part back, you know. And the biggest learning for myself is probably that I should never, never think to myself that something is too big, you know. Rather put myself out there, try my best, fail, go back home, don't be sad about it, it's not a big deal, and then go for the next one, right? For example, I spoke with Chris, we will probably search for another race, not 100 miles, but a bit less. So we want to repeat this stuff again, because, you know, that is how you grow. That is how also not necessarily physically. I don't even know what this is doing to you physically, if it really is beneficial for you. But this is above all mentally, that you're making huge, huge, huge gains, and where you're doing such a mental feat that I really think you are kind of altering, or you are giving an update to your nervous system, to the brain cells which you have, to your neurons. Yeah, because your brain needs to adapt during this run, right? Your brain needs to adapt during this run. Trust me, you have a lot of thinking time, you have a lot of alone time, so you have a lot of thoughts, a lot of dark thoughts, a lot of beautiful thoughts, a lot of strange thoughts, sometimes no thoughts at all, and sometimes just walking, no thinking. And like that, it's a mix of different kind of states of mind. So I really can't wait to repeat these kind of experiences, to do this kind of stuff again, you know, because I always, always, always want to test myself. For me, it's not enough to do only known stuff. I love running. I think that is also important. You need to love running it to some degree, you know. You need to like running to actually be able to kind of enjoy or to kind of appreciate an ultra marathon, you know. Just the fact that you're out there for a day literally and you're just running, you're just moving forward, that you can appreciate that, this gift that it was given to you. And I really could, you know, I was super, when I started this run, I wasn't thinking to myself, oh, I still have 20 plus hours or something. No, I was pumped, man. I was super happy to get going. I was just looking forward to each kilometer. I was enjoying the aid station. I was even joking around with the volunteers there. I had a good time, you know, I was enjoying myself. And that is what it's all about. You can't take yourself too serious when you take this, when you do this kind of stuff. Big learning for me as well. I always try to have a smile, you know, not this fake smile, like, not like that, but like really, I was just like enjoying myself. I was speaking with the people there, engaging, you know, asking questions. Like I said, cracking some jokes at the aid stations, speaking with people who were running besides me, and then continue. You know, that is also super, super essential. So with that being said, it was absolutely horrible, but also absolutely beautiful at the same time. I would also like to thank Eric McCarthy, of course, and Richard Runs Trails, two people who gave for Chris and me a few really, really good tips for ultra running. Thank you very much, my friends. And it was horrible, it was beautiful, and I would do it 10 out of 10 again, and I will. So thank you very much for watching. Subscribe to the channel for more. Sorry for not posting so many training routines lately. I will go back to it again. I will probably either do my first training session today, it's Wednesday today, or this evening or tomorrow. Of course, no burpees because my feet is still a bit swollen, but now I, for example, I can walk normally again, but I will do some dips and pull-ups, for example. And then I will also start posting some routines again. So don't hesitate, ask me your questions down below if you have any. Thank you very much for your support, for your interest, of course, if you really watch this video all the way through. I really appreciate you guys, and I hope to speak to you soon. And I hope to exchange with you in the comments down below. Peace, and on to the next one, friends.